chronic rhinosinusitis. This is the topic. We all have four sets of sinuses, four pairs. So this is the first pair. This is the second set. Around near the eye, you have the third set, and last pair you have way behind the nose. So totally you have four pairs. So when there is inflammation of the sinuses, it's considered as sinusitis, and the duration of complaint is less than 3 months, it is acute sinusitis, and if the complaint is more than 3 months, it's considered as chronic rhinosinusitis. So this chronic rhinosinusitis, it can be because of bacteria, bacterial cause, or fungal cause, or it can be granulomatous lesion. So in this topic, in this video, we are going to concentrate on bacterial cause leading to chronic rhinosinusitis. The common complaint of the patient will be, complaints of the patient will be, they'll say that they have a complaint for more than 3 months, and the complaints are nasal block, nasal discharge, or they feel that some discharge is going behind the nose, and they have hawking sensation, they have to clear the throat often, and sometimes some cough also, or irritation of the throat, and along with that they'll have facial discomfort, headache, and altered smell also. These are the common complaints. So on examination, we need to put in an endoscope, we have to do a nasal endoscopy, and when you do a nasal endoscopy, we find there is pus discharge. This is a diagram and this is a real photograph. You have a pus discharge here, or it can be, you may find nasal polyps. Either it can be a discharge or it can be nasal polyp. So you have chronic rhinosinusitis of two types, that is with polyps and without polyp, you may have a discharge, two types. Now coming to the investigation, when you do a routine blood test, if you have an acute infection on top of a chronic rhinosinusitis, you may find that bacterial, the cell count will be more, and from that we can make out whether it's a bacterial infection or viral infection. And when we do a C-reactive protein, CRP, the values will be high. And one of the common predisposing factor for chronic rhinosinusitis is allergic rhinitis. So in the blood, if you do an absolute eosinophilic count, and if the patient happen to be allergic, or if they have, they're suffering from allergic rhinitis or allergic form of rhinosinusitis, they may have the count increased, will be more. In that case, the duration is also more, say for months and years together, we like to do a skin prick test or in vitro test to find out what are the specific factors of the allergens. Now along with this, we like to take biopsy of the polyp and the biopsy of the mucosa inside. That is usually done during the surgical time, during the surgery. And as I have shown the picture during the nasal endoscopy, if you happen to find a pus discharge, under endoscopic guidance, we like to take a swab of the pus and send it for culture sensitivity, so that we come to know which specific bacteria is involved and which specific antibiotic can be given against that. And especially in case of polyps or allergy, history of allergy, we like to do vitamin D assay. And last, we would like to go ahead and do a CT scan of the sinuses. But the CT scan, why I am saying last is that, well, CT scan of the sinus is usually done after giving a full course of medical treatment. Only after that we'll do a CT scan. So let me tell you the full course of medical treatment. So treatment, medical management will be, and before that, let me tell you about the CT scan. So this is a normal CT scan, and this is a CT scan patient suffering from chronic rhinosinusitis. So in this CT scan, if you see, all the sinuses are black in color. That is normal. If it happened to be white in color, so that means it is not normal. It is some sort of infection there, or it can be a mass lesion also. This case is a diagnosed case of chronic rhinosinusitis. So coming to the treatment, so we'll start with antibiotic. Usually we prescribe antibiotic for a long period, say about 2 to 3 weeks, the full course of antibiotic. And along with that, we'll advise nasal wash. This nasal wash, there will be a sachet will be given along with that, which contains salt and baking powder. So this nasal wash you have to do 3 times daily. So if you want to know only about the nasal wash, you can log into, you can type in YouTube, you can type Dr. Zakir Hussain, ENT nasal wash. So you'll get all the details about the nasal wash alone, how to use it and what is the technique of using it. So this nasal wash, it can be with salt, with baking powder, and if you want, we can add up 5 to 10 ml of iodine also. Or instead of this, what you can do, if the doctor has prescribed you a steroid nasal spray, this steroid nasal spray, you can puff into this, at least 4 or 6 puffs into this, and you can use a nasal wash. So nasal wash has to be done 3 times daily. So the next treatment will be steroid nasal spray. If you happen to use a steroid nasal spray along with this, you don't have to use it separately. So nasal spray for adult, it will be 2 puff on each nostrils there, and it will be twice daily. So if you want to know the details about steroid nasal spray alone, you have to, in YouTube, just log, you can just type Dr. Zakir Hussain ENT nasal wash. You will get all the details of the nasal spray. What is the mechanism of action? What are the indications of use of nasal spray? And what are the common complications and how to prevent the complications? All that you will get in the single video. It's a very short video, say about 3 or 4 minutes only. And next, sometimes, especially in case of nasal polyp, we may need to give a course of oral steroids. So suppose after calculating the dose, if it happened that you need to go 10-50 milligram dose per day, then each tablet is 10 milligrams, we'll give you 5 tablets which has to be taken together in the morning, and no tablets in the afternoon and nil in the night. So that will be taken for 5 days continuously. So after that, we have to slowly taper the dose. So after 5 days, it'll be 4 tablets for next 5 days, 3 tablets for next 5 days, 2 tablets for next 5 days, and last 1 tablet, that is 10 milligram dose for last 5 days. So that is one way of taking the medication, oral steroid. Or some of the doctors may say, same dose you can divide into 3 times a day. That also is fine. So let me tell you some of the side effects of oral steroids. This is a strong medication, it has got so many side effects. Those patients who are suffering from hypertension or high blood pressure, their blood pressure may shoot up. Likewise, if they are suffering from diabetes mellitus, their blood sugar may shoot up. If they have peptic ulcer, the acidity may go up. Likewise, they have glaucoma, that is increased pressure in the eye. That also will be increased. And it may precipitate cataract in the eyes. And they may have a weight gain, appetite will increase. And these are the common summer side effects. And one more side effect, that bones may become weak, and spontaneous fracture has sometimes been reported. So these side effects are usually seen when you take it for a long duration. So what I'm giving here now is a short course. Even then, it is better that you know the side effects. If suppose your doctor has prescribed the steroids, it's better that you meet a physician also and every alternate day, and please check the blood sugar and blood pressure. And he will do the needful, whatever is necessary. If the sugar is more or has gone up, or the blood pressure has gone up, your medication can be altered. So keep it at a normal level. So that is about oral steroids. Don't forget, you have to take it after food only, and you have better you take proton pump inhibitor and antacids like, so that will be omeprazole or pantoprazole before food. That also will be twice daily. Now, if you are suffering from severe allergy also, and in spite of all this, it is not getting controlled, we may need to add up one antihistamine tablet. But most of this the other medications which I have mentioned previously, like oral steroids and nasal spray, will take care of your allergy also. Now, these are the common, this is how we manage medically. So in spite of all this medical management, so still, after our medical management, we like to take a CT scan. And in spite of all this medical management, it is not getting cured. That means you have gone into a stage of for surgery. So with this surgery, which is done with an endoscopic, that's what E stands for, we would like to clear up all the sinuses, that is sinus surgery. And we have to bring back the normal function of the sinus. That's F stands for functional. So functional endoscopic sinus surgery, this is the name of the operation. If we have decided to operate on you, we need to admit you. So as soon as you're admitted, we like to take a concern from you. In that concern paper, it'll be written what is the diagnosis. That will be chronic rhinosinusitis, that is with or without complication. and the surgery will be written as bilateral functional endoscopic sinus surgery, and the complications of surgery, which I shall tell you shortly. And we'll go through all the complications, and you have to sign and write your name also with a date. And the doctor who has been explaining all this, he also will countersign and put in a date. So meanwhile, the staff nurse who is there with you, she will do all the necessary investigation which is necessary to make you fit, to show you that you are fit enough to be taken to the operation theatre, which is called as the pre-anesthesia panel. So with all these reports, you need to meet a physician. So physician will examine you and he will give you fitness for surgery, and with all these reports you need to meet the anesthetist, who will examine you again and he'll tell you whether you are fit for anesthesia or not. And by the way, suppose you are suffering from any cardiac illness, any problem, and you have been taking aspirin, clobetrol and Brilanta, any sort of cardiac related medications, you have to stop it at least 5 days before the surgery. Do not forget about it. Now, when all this workup has been done, suppose your surgery is next day, the previous day and night, from night 12 p.m. onwards, you are not supposed to take anything or drink anything or eat anything. So next day morning is the surgery, and approximately it takes about 3 to 4 hours. That means from the time you leave your room and when you reach back to your room, it takes about 3 to 4 hours. So before going into that, let me tell you about the complications of surgery. For ease of understanding, let me divide it into three headings. One is nasal complication, the second one being orbital complication, and the last being intracranial complications. So nasal complications, you have many, but let me tell you the main one, that will be bleeding. So the bleeding can be intraoperative, that we'll manage. It can be postoperative when you are in the room or in the hospital ward, or it can be maybe you develop it at home. So in case you develop in the ward or when you are at home, you have to meet the doctor. We will meet you and we'll try to control the bleed in the hospital ward or room itself. In case we are not able to manage and it's still profusely bleeding, you have to take it back in the operation theater to control the bleed. That is about the nasal complication. Now coming to orbital complication. Orbital complication, the orbit has got so many muscles. There is a possibility or chance that one of the muscles may get damaged because of the surgery. In that case, the common complaint is going to be, they'll say the patient says, I see double vision. In that case, we have to take a CT scan and MRI, and the ophthalmologist will be called, and what is needed will be done as per the degree of damage. The second complication will be if there is a breach in the bone between the nose and the orbit or the eye, what happens is the blood may sweep in into the eyes. In that case, what will happen, there will be increasing swelling around the eyes, around the lids and around the eyes, lower lid and the upper lid, and it will be increasing slowly, and there will be pain in the eyes, and there will be protrusion of the eyeball, which is called the proptosis. Along with that, sometimes it's not taken care of at the right time, the vision also may come down. To start with, the color vision, then the patient, he may lose the vision also if the appropriate care has not been given. So that is the orbital complication. Now coming to intracranial complication, see, the brain, it is covered, it has got a covering which is called as a meninges. So in that meninges is filled with a fluid which is called as a cerebrospinal fluid, and the brain floats in the cerebrospinal fluid. So if there is a damage in the covering, which is the meninges, during the surgery, there will be leak of this cerebrospinal fluid. So if the leak happened is small, we'll manage it conservatively, and maybe your length of stay in the hospital is going to be a few more days. In case that damage is more and it has not been able to control with the conservative management, then we will go ahead and do a CT scan and MRI, and we need to take you back to the operation theater, and we have to seal the damaged area. Repair of the cerebrospinal fluid leak. Now the next complication is the covering of the brain, which is called the meninges. If that get infected, the infection coming from the sinuses, then it leads to meningitis, and it can lead to fits also, convulsions also. The next complication be this infection, it can spread into the brain and in result in brain abscess also. Sometimes when there's a small breach in the covering, the air from the sinus, it can track inside the brain and around the brain or inside the brain, and can lead to a condition called pneumocephalus, where the patient complains of severe pain on that particular side post-operatively. So in that case, we need to take a urgent CT scan and assess that how big is that air bubble and what are the secondary effect is producing on the brain. At the same time, the neurosurgeon also will be called in, and what is necessary will be done. And sometimes we need to take you back to the operation theater to remove the air bubble from inside before it produces any further damage. So these are the complications of functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Now, when you come back to the room, when you come back to the room after the surgery, for next 4 hours after surgery, you are not supposed to take anything orally, eat or drink anything. So meanwhile, your staff nurse, and this is, by the way, this will be your position post-operatively. And this next 4 hours, the IV drip, IV fluids will be going on, and the duty staff nurse, she'll walk in and she'll check all the parameters like heart rate, blood pressure, oxygen saturation and temperature, and if there is any bleeding from the nose, and whether there are any complaints of vomiting or any other sort of complaints. So usually at this period, you may get a few complaints which I'd like to tell you. These complaints are: one, you may have a dull headache post-operatively. You may get facial pain, which is also dull, not severe. And there'll be watering of the eyes. And all these three complaints is because you have a nasal pack which is placed post-operative period. Because of the nasal pack, you get all these complaints. This nasal pack, usually it is removed the next day itself, or maybe maximum 48 hours. Once the nasal pack is removed, all these complaints will come down. Along with that, you may have vomiting. You may get vomiting, and you may get slight, maybe you'll feel that you're warm. So that is normal. So these are the small complaints which are seen post-operatively. IV antibiotic will be going on along with painkillers, and the nasal pack will be removed after the next day or the second day. Once that is done, when the nasal pack is removed, it may bleed for about 5 minutes or so. So all the blood may flow out, and the staff nurse, after that, she'll apply nasal drops maybe 2 or 3 times, and by about 10 or 15 minutes, you'll be normal. That particular day, or maybe the subsequent days also, you may have slight bleeding, especially so when you sneeze or when you try to blow your nose. Now, the discharge time, that will be usually within 24 hours to 48 hours after surgery. So the total number of days, if there is no complication, it's a straightforward case, maximum number of days in the hospital will be 3 to 4 days, not more than that. That will be the routine in such type of cases. During discharge, you will get the following medication. That is the full course of antibiotic, say for 2 to 3 weeks. Painkiller, that will be only for 2 to 3 days. And you will be advised to start nasal wash the next day, not the same day of discharge, the next day of discharge, next day of removing the nasal pack. And that has to be done 3 times daily. And you will be advised to start on steroid nasal spray, not soon after surgery, 1 week after surgery. And this both nasal spray, steroid nasal spray and nasal wash, you need to continue till your surgeon says to stop it. You have to continue till then, maybe for a few months or so. So that your surgeon will decide on when you are on the regular follow-up after doing a repeat nasal endoscopy. So the regular follow-up is most important. The first follow-up is going to be after first week, then after 2 weeks, then after 2 weeks, then it will be after 6 weeks after surgery. After that, it will be every 3 months or 6 months following that. So you have to keep on regular follow-up, and we need to do a nasal endoscopy to find out whether it has come back to normal or the polyp is recurring or not, so that we can do necessary things, whatever is necessary, if we happen to see you in the early stages. That's why. Now, coming to the take-home message. So the most important thing will be, you have to be on nasal wash and nasal spray regularly. You have to drink plenty of fluid and be on balanced diet, and wash your hands properly and try not to touch your nose repeatedly. Avoid smoking. Please do not smoke. And if you have allergy, take all the proper treatment to prevent allergy. Likewise, you have to avoid cold environment, and if possible, try to humidify your room. These are the common take-home messages. So this is how we manage chronic rhinosinusitis. Thank you so much.